in Jewish faith were Pharisees, were Tzedekim, as we say in Hebrew, Perushim, Pharisees in English, were easing that we don't know exactly where, who they were, as, but they were described by Josephus Flavius, and were a great testimony of the different movements in Jewish faith in the first century are the Dead Sea Scrolls, and are all the, what we call in the Jewish studies, the Apocrypha, the books that were outside the canon, the traditional Jewish canon of the Bible. For instance, the Book of Jubilees, it shows us that there was a whole spectrum of faith in the frame of the Jews of that time. And afterwards, Christianity developed its own way from this group. So really, we are brothers in the deepest way, in the sense of the word brothers, because the rabbinic Judaism, which is my Judaism, is the Judaism of the Jews of today, is a development of one movement in the Yehuda of the first century, of the first century, and in a parallel way, and afterwards, the Virgin, in some way, of Christianity. But the roots, the values, the spiritual values, they as it used to be said in German, the Weltanschauung of Jews and Christians is Christians is very close, is very similar. We have really differences, of course. The faith in Jesus,
you will follow, please.
For us, yeah. For you is the Son of God in some way. It's a theme in itself that, if you wish, we can speak about afterwards. But regarding the faith in a transcendental God, God of transcendental, not transcendental God, regarding the faith in the sanctity which is in each human being, regarding the respect that one has to have regarding the other. These are very common values that we are sharing. Because that, and in this sense, I feel that we are brothers. And two points more. I have a continuous correspondence with the Pope when he writes to me. He begins, "My beloved brother," and when I write to him, I begin the way that I write to him is, "My beloved brother," and that's true. It's a really feeling of brotherhood. It's not really the word. And the second point is this. The book of Genesis teaches us that the relationship between brothers is not an easy task, because that would clash during 2,000 years, one or the other, in different points. were moments of understanding and were moments of clashes. But the end of Genesis is that all the family of Jacob, yeah, all the brothers, all the tribes were in peace. And this must be our north, to be in peace, in understanding, because both of us have a mission to help each the other in the building of a better reality, human reality.
Thank you.
It's good to study in the same moment, because one can say that you can choose your friends, but then your brothers. I want to say two things. The first one is the context. Because sometimes we forget when the phrase was used. When the Pope visited the synagogue in Rome for the first time, John Paul. And it was not the first Pope to visit the synagogue in Rome. There were popes who used to go there to populate the Jews. And the community with Rabbi had to come out and to greet the Pope, give him, offer him the Torah, and he was giving it back, saying, you read but you do not understand. So after such meetings, there is a Pope coming to the synagogue saying, you are our other brothers, is completely different feeling and meaning. So this is the first thing I want to say and to stress, that this is the reversal of history and the reversal of science. So I think it works quite hard and powerful. And the second thing, I think that our understanding of our brotherhood depends on our understanding of God. We both understand God as our Father. The image of God in the Hebrew Bible, in the New Testament, is our Father. God doesn't just behave as Father. He is Father. It's completely different idea. To behave as a father means to give somebody food, drink, or growth, or happiness. But to be the father means to share his life, to give life. And this is what we read in Genesis, beginning the first and the third chapter, that God has created us in His picture and image. And I don't know, especially the Orthodox Church is very careful reading the passage, picture and image. Because picture is something without any movement, is something static. You are a picture of God in your inner life, but image is something dynamic. So, what does it mean, dynamic? That you become like God more and more and more and more. And the only way to do it is to accept His life coming to you. And give His life coming to you. So, this is the source of our brotherhood. I am created as the image and picture of God, and Rabbi is created as the image and picture of God. And I am not created as His image and picture, and He is not created as my picture and image. But we are both created in the picture and image of God, our Father, and He shares His life with us. So the brotherhood is very, very deep, and we all in God But we need to talk about God not as a theory, not as a name, not as a word, abstract, but a living person, and with experience of him being living and dynamic, and that changes everything.
Following this, I would like to ask you how Christian thinking about the people of Israel and what Jewish think about people of Israel. It is the same definition. What can you tell about this? So what does it mean for you, people of Israel, and what it means for Christians?
You first.
Older brother.
It's not my order. I know that for a Christian, the name Israel is understood as the Christians are the new people of Israel. For us, the name Israel is something special. Why? What means to be a Jew? What means to be an Israel, part of the people of Israel? We exist before the Greeks and the Romans. We, in our Jewish structure, we don't make a difference between religion, people, nationality. It was a wrong words, as you know, from the New Testament. For us to be a Jew, or to be part of the people of Israel, means to be at the same time part of the people, part of a religion, to have this religion, and to be also, to have a state. The Jewish state, the Israel, the state of Israel, the idea of the state of Israel, it's very difficult to speak about that, because it's a very difficult thing, because Israel must be a democratic state and so on and so on. But the idea of the creation of the state of Israel was to establish a Jewish state in the historical Jewish place. Is to be a Jew means to belong to a people, to have the same faith. And when you go to Israel, okay, a Muslim will be can have the citizenship of Israel, and he is an Israeli, has the citizenship of Israeli. But for a Jew, it is a whole package. You cannot be a Jew or part of the people of Israel being a Christian. You can have Israeli nationality. You can be a citizen of Israel and have a passport in which appears a religion, Christian, and you have all the rights of each one of the citizens in Israel. But to be a Jew, historically, I will tell you a story. In the 60s, appeared a person who saved a lot of Jews during the Second World War. A Jew who dressed the uniform of SS there and attacks with a group of people, convoys with Jews, and he killed the German soldiers of the convoy, and he saved a lot, very well established, that he saved a lot of Jews. When he arrived in Israel,
After the war, he was a Jew. After the war, he decided to be a Catholic and a priest. And he became a priest. When he arrived to Israel, he said, give me, please, immediately, because there is a law that a Jew who comes to Israel has the right to receive immediately the Israeli citizenship. But you are not a Jew, okay, because that this is a Jewish thing. There is a whole procedure in order to have a citizenship. So the people remained astonished, and this case reached the Supreme Court of Israel. And from the three judges, two decided it's impossible to consider him. He is our brother, we love him. We recognize everything that they did, but from an historical point of view, he is not totally part of the Jewish people. Why? Because the definition of being a Jew, we can find this definition in the book of Ruth. In the book of Ruth, when Ruth says to Naomi, where you, your God is going to be my God. Remember? And your people is going to be my people. And when you are going to be buried, there it will be also the place where I am going to be buried. It's no, in Jewish conception, to be a Jew means not merely nationality, no? Not only to say, I belong, I have Jewish roots. You must have also the Jewish identity. It's a whole. It's a package. Now, I understand the Christian position. Because the Christian says, okay, what's the change? What occurred something? I'm going into your field, but let me say how I see Christianity. And they consider themselves Israel. And that's good. That's good because you took the Jewish values and you said, okay, let us go ahead, let us universalize the Jewish values, because this is what Christianity did. Christianity universalized Jewish values. At the beginning, the first Christians were Jews, and the first Christians really, Christianity was a inner Jewish question. Afterwards, came many people who were not Jewish and adopted this new faith, and they spread this faith in Europe, especially, this was the beginning, and they spread many of Jewish values and of the Jewish aspects of the Jewish faith, and they consider themselves, okay, maybe that we must continue Jewish history, taking into account that the center of Jewish history, the Beit HaMikdash, the holy Mikdash, the temple, the holy temple in Jerusalem, was destroyed by Titus in 70 AD. It was a historical, very deep movement of people that consider that Jewishness, that Israel is very important, and that the idea of Israel must be spread in the world. And with this I finish, in accordance to Maimonides, the famous Rambam, Spain, 12th century, this is the plan of God, that the Islam and Christianity are going to pave together with us the way for the Messiah. Okay, you and us are waiting for the Messiah. The Messiah for us, for first, it's another Messiah, but you are waiting for the Messiah, Parousia, and we are waiting for the Messiah. In other words, we're waiting and working for a better world.
Makes sense. So how does
it stand? The best answer is a mystery. There's no simple answer. Rabbi said that we are new Israel. Does mean that the first one stopped to exist?
Who continues existing parallel to you?
The problem on our side is, and I can easily understand what you said, the problem on our side is that nearly through 20 centuries we used to speak about being new Israel in a way of replacement. Okay, Jews used to be the people of God, but they are no longer the people of God. Thus, now there is a new covenant in Christ Jesus, so the old one is abolished. And there's a question, what is the place for Israel in history? The oldest old covenant is abolished. We replace Israel. And we used to speak in such a way since 2nd century, I'm afraid, till the nearly Nostra Aetate. So we stopped to speak in such a way 50 years ago. And we come back now to the ideas of the Bible and to the letters of St. Paul. And Paul, in a letter to Romans, chapter 11, probably this is the most important passage now when we speak in Israel, about Israel. Well, Paul says that God doesn't stop, God doesn't change his election and his choice. So if you choose somebody, his choice is forever. God doesn't sorry for my English. God doesn't revoke his choosing and his calling. His calling lasts forever. So Israel is Israel and is chosen people of God. This is what Paul says in Romans 11. There's a picture of the olive tree, probably the most famous picture by Paul, speaking about the relationship between church and Israel. So there is a root which is people of God. Israel is a root. And the root becomes a tree. And then, in a moment of the time, God implants some rungs to the same tree, but the tree is still the same tree. So it's not a picture of cutting the tree and planting the new one. No, still the same tree. And the tree is a living organism. So we are implanted. We as a church are implanted. So even when we say you Israel, it doesn't mean that the first one is not important. And so now is a place for mystery, because what is the connection between Israel and a new Israel? We say we are one, we are united. But in a way which doesn't change each of us. So we still are the same. We are Christians, you are Jews, but we are united. So this is the answer for New Israel. But there's something more important, I think, when you speak about people of Israel and people of God. That means the way God reveals himself in the world. That his revelation goes through the community, through the people. Of course, both of us, we read Bible. But Bible is written in the context of the people of God. First, we had a faith coming from mouth to mouth, from person to person, from Abraham to Isaac, from Isaac to Jacob, and so on. So God called the people, not the writers. The writers at the end. Sometimes I say that God used to write the books at the end. But first there is a proclamation, and there is a living faith in the living book of God. And that's why God is also a hero of our history. His people rises in history, grows in history, goes through the history. So there are quite a few important matters in the figure of King of God.
Okay, you said that really, that God tells us and explains us the things. So I would like to ask you what God tells us in this tower, the battle. 1 month ago, it was the day of Judaism here in Łódź, and Your Excellency organized it, and it was reflections on the Tower of Babel. So what this story tells to Jews and to Christians? How do you explain it? Maybe God doesn't want to follow the dialogue because he mixes languages. Because he mixed languages.
Yeah.
There are several explanations about the story of the Tower of Babel. The simple explanation is that the people of Babel, I use the Hebrew pronunciation of the word,
it's also Polish.
Babel is Polish. Yeah, those people sound Polish.
It sounds Polish.
It's simple. They developed technology, a new technology for that time, because we have a description that how they improve the production of bricks and of construction. So they felt that they're very important and powerful, and so they challenged God. They said, okay, we got something very similar to what is going on in our days. A human being feels we develop at such a degree science and technology that we are almost like God, and I would say that there are many people that consider themselves that they have the power, God's powers. So they decided to build up a tower defying, challenging heaven. Okay, this is one explanation. The second explanation could be this. At the beginning of the story appears the idea that all the people in Babel had only one language, and that having only one language, the text says, this empowered them to take a decision and to build this tower. What was God's punishment to the people there? He confused the languages. But don't forget that in the biblical conception, God punish a, so to say in the Talmud, a breaking the elements, the same the elements which conduct the people to commit the error, to commit the transgression. Is some exegeter, some interpreter, very great interpreter of the Torah, of the Chumash, of the Bible, at the beginning of the Renaissance, said this question, asking himself this question: how is it possible that there is only one language? In here, all of you are speaking Polish, but there are nonsense. In the language, you can make an interpretation of a word in some way, with such color, and another word can interpret the word in another sense. It's the same word, but must be the possibility of interpretations. Only when you are living in a reality of a dictator, in a reality in which there is only one language permitted, the language of the dictator, of the tyrant, only in this reality he can impose a one language, and because that all the idea was totally an idea, a nonsense idea, to build something in order to demonstrate how great we are. Now, the last explanation from a Midrash from the Middle Ages. What was so bad? The Midrash says that when they were in the middle of the construction, and one of the workers fell and died, is the organizer said, "Oh God, what occurred here? Oivai." One oivai, this is from Yiddish, oivai, is we lost the worker. Excuse me. When one brain fall and destroy, they said, "Oivai, we lost the brain." When one man fall and kill, he said nothing. It was clear. I didn't tell exactly the story. The story is, when one brain fall and was destroyed, it was a terrible pain for them. When one human being fall and was killed, it was nothing for them. They were indifferent. They gave more importance to the bricks than to human beings' life. The Pope Francis told me that when we analyze this together, really he took this explanation. This midrash was very important for him. He enjoyed a lot this explanation, and in certain opportunity he told me, "You know what, I quoted your Midrash and I said, from a Jew I learned that the explanation of the Tower of Babel is so and so."
I listened to in the last 1 month, I think. Explaining
the Tower of Babel.
Tower of Babel. And all of you the same way, meaning that there was nothing positive in one language. And the people were forced to speak one language. What is wonderful for me is exactly the experience of Francis. We want to listen to your explanation for itself. So this is what Pope Benedict XVI taught us to do. Let's first listen to the Jews explaining the Hebrew Bible. And this is important, how Israel today gives an explanation to his own text. And so it's always a privilege to listen to Rabbi explaining the Hebrew Bible. It always helps us, because sometimes I think that we do not ask the same questions to the same text. But of course there is an explanation which is privileged in the church. It's privileged because he works together with the book of the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, the Pentecost event. And what is the connection that, to say briefly, the Tower of Babel, you have one nation, and the people who are, in a sense, very pious, because what they build is in fact a temple. They follow the pattern of the temples of Babylon. So they build a huge, huge tower, and on the top there will be a temple. So they are very pious. But they behave exactly opposite to what they were told to do by God, because God told them, go to the world and fill the world and give birth to your children. And so we fill the world with your presence. And they said, no, we stay and we build a sign for us not to be dispersed. And so they do not obey God and they build a temple. And in fact they say, we will build a monument for us. This is what the Hebrew text says exactly. We will build a monument for us. So they build a temple. But the temple will be a monument for them. Not to God, to them. It sounds very familiar. I mean, because it can happen everywhere. Everyone at each time. So, the Pentecost event is exactly opposite. So, because apostles go out of from the room and they say, and they proclaim the glory of God. They speak about great works of God, great deeds of God. So, they proclaim the glory of God. They leave the monument to God, not to themselves. And this is exactly what makes them one. Because when they wanted to build a monument for themselves, they were dispersed. This is how the pride operates. You want to be somebody, and this is the beginning of difficult division. And when you proclaim the glory of God, you come together to one body. So, probably because of that unity of two passages of the Bible, we take a special importance to that explanation. But I am really grateful for what you said about the power of God.
Thank you. It is wonderful to make dialogue between people who like to listen to each other and to share and to learn from each other. So it's much easier to speak about similarities, but let's talk also about differences. And I must ask these questions. So how Jews interpret who was Jesus?
Jesus?
Who was Jesus? How Jews interpreted?
We interpreted Jesus as, in the same way as in the Gospels, his fellows called Jesus Rabbi. He was a master. You know, many of his teachings or views of the interpretation of the Torah have a parallel in the rabbis, in other rabbis of his time, in Hillel, for instance, or rabbis after his time. He was a master, a rabbi, a teacher in his time, very spiritual, very special. That is it. This is the Jewish view of Jesus. Two things I would like to add. One regarding what you said in your answer, that since Benedictus, that he as Pope said, it's very interesting to hear the explanations of the rabbis. This idea was written in Evangelium Gaudium in an explicit way by Pope Francis at the end of the chapter in which he analyzes the relationship with the Jews. The second point is, yes, about the description that Benedictus gives about who was Jesus in the first chapter of his book, Jesus of Nazareth, which is not doctrine, the doctrinal book. And the description is very interesting. It's in accordance also to verses in the New Testament in which he compares Jesus to Moses. Okay, for us, it's not so. He says that Jesus is, it's very interesting theologically for you, it must be very interesting because he's a human being. Moses was very human for us, and for us God is one, and this, the idea of God, the Holy Spirit, and the Son, it's not, we don't accept that, of course. But the way that Ratzinger presented the image of Jesus as some creature in the middle between God, and it compares with Moses. In accordance to my understanding of what he tries to say, is that he was a human being with a special spirit. Of course, with a special spirit, a human being. We make a great difference. A human being is forever a human being. And this is the difference between us and the Christian vision.
Yes, amazing. I know that probably most of the public are Christians, but the same question. So, who is a Jesus for Christians?
Well, I would start from the title Rabbi, because it is true that he is first called Rabbi. You take fifth chapter of Luke. A beautiful moment when Christ Jesus meets Simon Peter for the first time. And he says to him, go into the boat and let us swim to the center of the lake and throw your net to catch the fish. But then Simon says, Rabbi, we have worked the whole night and we got nothing. But because of your word, I will obey you. So this is still the moment where Jesus is the rabbi for Simon Peter. But then Peter sees hundreds of fish in his boat, and he has to kneel down before Jesus, and he says, in Greek is Kyrie, Lord. Go away, because I am a sinner. So this is the first moment when Peter has no longer called him Rabbi. He calls him Kyrios.
Amen.
And of course you know that in a Septuagint, Kyrios is the word embracing the name of God. This is the proclamation of the gospel. And then again, that is in Matthew, when they are on the same plane the next time. And you know the story that Peter tried to walk on the water, and he started to die. So, and he said, "Save me." So the rabbi becomes Lord and Savior. That's our way we see Jesus. And this is a huge change from Rabbi to Kyrios and to Savior. And then the second thing I want to say is that you said that probably the majority of the congregation is Christian, so probably you had a chance to be at the Mass today and listen to the Gospel. Today's Gospel was speaking about Mount Tabor, where Jesus took Peter, John, and James. And the Gospel says that the cloud, sign of God from Israel, from Exodus, the cloud came, and from the cloud there was a voice coming, "He is my beloved son, listen to him." And the voice came to the three people who used to listen to Moses and to Elijah, because those two persons, we believe the testimony was that Moses and Elijah, they came to Jesus on Mount Tabor, and Peter, James, and John saw the three of them talking and talking. So the voice comes and says, "Listen to him." They used to listen to Moses, and they used to listen to Elijah, to the law and to the prophets. And then the voice says, "Listen to him." And again, it doesn't mean stop listening to Moses and do not listen to Elijah. So forget the law and forget the prophets. But the voice says, this is how we explain the passage. If you want to obey Moses, look how Jesus explains the law. And if you want to be open for all the promises given by prophets, welcome Jesus in your life, and all the promises will be fulfilled in your life. And the promises given by the prophets, the promise of peace, the promise of happiness, the promise of salvation, they come to you and they become Word incarnate in your life when you accept Jesus. So, this is what I said already during the interview in the video, that we cannot understand us without you. You probably can understand yourself without us, but we cannot understand us without you. We do not understand Jesus without Moses and Elijah.
That's true.
Thank you.
Totally true.
I want to ask you one more difficult question. So, what are the most
difficult?
It was not okay. So, I difficult. So one of the most difficult problems, clashes between Jews and Christians to solve in the dialogue? What is the points you discuss the most? What are the problems you don't solve? My question is about differences, the biggest clashes.
Could be different. We have to separate two things. Never we are going to agree theologically. Why? Because of that time, the time of the gospel of Jesus, were Jews that accepted Jesus and were Jews that didn't. When you speak about the miracles performed by Jesus, okay, I can bring examples from the Talmud regarding miracles in the same way that were performed by rabbis. This is not the essence of, this must not, could not be, nevermore, the essence of our talking, of our dialogue. When we speak about, at a certain opportunity, I asked my very good friend in Rome, tell me, what should be the next step in our dialogue? He said, the theological one. Afterwards, I asked from him my bibliography, and he gave me. I told him, give me my bibliography, and okay, he quoted two books. Interesting. One written by an Argentinian person who devotes years and years of study. He develops some very interesting theories. The two truths that have to complement one the other. And the other is a book, La Promesse, from Lustiger. Lustiger, a Jew who ended his life being Archbishop Emeritus of Paris. Aaron Lustiger. Okay. Is so when we speak about theology, the thing we must speak about, this is how, with great humility I understand, is how one can be the complement of the other. There are two truths. I go back to Nostra Aetate. The first covenant was not revoked, and this is the English version of Nostra Aetate, was not revoked. No, it doesn't, the text doesn't say is not abolished. It's not revoked, it's a stronger word. The way I see that the dialogue must continue. To see how one really can help the other, and each one has to continue in his own way, in his own identity, as Pope Francis stressed that emphatically in a lot of opportunities. The idea of our dialogue is not more as it was in the Middle Ages and after the Middle Ages, to convince one the other. We remember disputes in the Middle Ages. Disputes now. This not more. What we must do from now onwards is to dialogue, to understand one the other, and with the hope that through this dialogue, the Jew can be a better Jew, and the Christian who is involved in this dialogue can improve his Christianity. You said this a few minutes ago. It's impossible for me to understand my Christianity without knowing what a Jew means. The idea is not who has the truth. You have your vision, I have my vision, but there are a lot of points in common. We can share, we must share a lot of points. Really, I had problems in dialogue with the persons with whom I developed a real deep dialogue. Because the other one never tried to convince me, okay, I have the truth. No, he explained me. I believe in this because this and this and this. And he tried to be empathic with me, trying to understand, okay, why do you believe in what you are believing? Well, what is your tradition? And not only, as I said before, our relationship is a very special, as a brotherhood, a quotation signs, relationship. So we are very close, each to the other, as it's the official policy of the Vatican. We have, I quote now what Cardinal Koch used to say at any opportunity, we are very related, we are related, we maintain a dialogue with all the cults, with all the religions, but in a special way with the Jews. I quoted him verbatim. Yeah? And this is the official point of the Catholic Apostolic Church. And that's true. And that's true. We are very close in many senses. Very, very close. The same credit. The same. The challenge is to go ahead in this dialogue, to fortify the dialogue, and to build new patterns which will give us the possibility, as I said before, to give to humankind the real message that I believe God is expecting from us.
To be honest, I also think that the problem is not theological. I remember what once Rabbi Greenberg told me. I said, you know, you
yes.
Greenberg told me that both Judaism and Christianity, they share the same message and way. The message is messianic, and the way is covenantal. It's a wonderful phrase. The message is messianic, and the way is covenantal. And so, there are a few pillars. We have a phrase. Faith is very strong. And if you read the modern theology in the Catholic Church, you will find the words by Cardinal Koch being common. We do not place anymore the dialogue with Jews in a place of interreligious dialogue. Our dialogue with Jews is not interreligious. Interreligious dialogue is with Muslims, with Buddhists, but not with Judaism. And you will find many, many theological books saying that Israel will be saved by Parousia. So this is our expectation of Messiah. We wait for him and we wait for him. Anyway, so the problem is not theological. The problem is, because you ask about what is difficult, not what is easy. What is difficult is the understanding of dialogue. Because for many of us, the main idea of dialogue is to get the truth. We need to know the truth. But dialogue, in fact, is a matter of building the relationship. This is what I know from the Jews. And there's some Polish Jews talking about it. All the examples of dialogue in the Bible, in the Hebrew language, you know, the dialogue between God and man. What are they for? When God starts dialogue with Adam, where are you? But he knows where he is. Why does he ask?
In order, the condition of Russian, in order to enter with him in words and dialogue.
It's not the truth. What is important in the dialogue? In that dialogue. But no, it's the truth.
The same occurred after Cain. Where is your brother? God knew where the brother is. Then what's the simple explanation of the Midrash quoted by Rashi? Rashi is the very exegete of the Bible. Is in order to enter with him in the dialogue. Yeah, not to abandon.
If he doesn't ask the question, Adam and Cain, they will never stop. They did something wrong. Now they hide themselves. They don't want to talk to God. So he's the one to start the relationship, to start the relationship from the beginning, again and again and again. That's why he enters the dialogue. Well, not to discover the truth, because he knows the truth, but he builds the relationship. And, well, okay, we know it. The problem is that we are in such a dialogue only 50 years. After nearly 2,000 of difficult history, and it's not so easy to change the matters in 50 years. So this is an awesome. But such a dialogue is still a very, very young tree between us. But we are patient.
The most important is never ever to forget that this must be the path, that this must be the way. Let me add one word.
Then I will add one word.
When the Pope was here, before coming to Poland to visit, to be in Auschwitz, Birkenau, he told me, I would like you be present when I'm going to be in Auschwitz, Birkenau. So after when we went out from Birkenau, his Polish journalist asked me about the importance of dialogue. And my answer that came from the deep of my heart was, take a look over these buildings, the buildings, the barracks in Birkenau. Would be a dialogue, these barracks would not have a presence in this place. You use power, destruction, you kill when the world and the power of the world disappears. And this is the way. The importance is to stress that from now and forever to die. You know, for us Jews, emet, the truth is in the hands of God. We cannot reach the truth. So when we begin a dialogue, we must, as you said, God knew the truth. But by the dialogue, he didn't abandon not Adam, neither Cain, neither Asis, neither the Asis. This is the power of dialogue, the power of words. When words disappear, it's terrible. The lack of words is violence, is the way of life, for us.
Well, this is exactly the sentence I wanted to add. Because when I speak about the dialogue, it doesn't mean that the truth is not important. The truth is important. But it's not the same as thinking about yourself that the truth is a possession. I remember my professor, you were like my professor of history. He came once to the classroom and he started to read the text. And the text, when in such a way, I got from the classroom, that the text was such a way. This is a temptation coming back again and again, also to Christians, to think about themselves as the possessors of truth. And the professor asks us, what do you think about the sentence? Is it true or wrong? Is it true or is it a heresy? And, you know, we are already in our second year of studies, so we are very young. So we said, well, this is wrong. There's something wrong with the sentence. And we said, okay, now let us think about the signature. The signature was John Paul II. His message for the Day of Peace in 1983. So to seek the truth is not the same as thinking about yourself as a possessor of truth. It goes with your faith, my faith, that the whole truth is given to us through Christ. So the whole truth is given to me by Christ. It doesn't mean that I possess the truth and that I know it in every single piece. This is what I want to tell
you. You both said that dialogue is a path to receive real brotherhood or relationship. How to talk or how to create a dialogue with that part of Christians or Jews who doesn't want to go into dialogue? What to do? How to go to the people who are afraid of dialogue, who doesn't see the future of the dialogue? Is it really the brotherhood between Jews and Christians possible? They don't believe in it. So how to work on it in church, in synagogue? How to work on it?
I have a temptation to start.
What?
I have a temptation to start.
Go on.
This is what Francis used to say, Pope Francis. This is the attraction of witnessing. You cannot force somebody to dialogue. And what are we doing now is, I hope that this is a testimony, and I hope it is attractive. So it is attractive that we start to follow us. So witnessing is attractive. And there is no way to force somebody to like it. That's all for myself.
That's true, but the real problem is not just how to inspire people for dialogue. Only people in the dialogue, in the Jewish Christian dialogue. The real question is how to inspire people to dialogue at all, in general. Are we real really dialogical creatures, are we prepared to hear the other? Really, each one is prepared to hear, really, the voice of his spouse, his wife. Are parents really prepared to hear the voice of their children? This is the first question. The second point is, I agree totally with you. We must be paradigms. This is what I did with Bergoglio when he was Archbishop of Buenos Aires. This was his intention. 31 programs we recorded for the television, for the special channel of the Archbishop in Buenos Aires. What was the first idea? This was my felt in my feeling. Excuse me, my feeling when we recorded the programs. That the programs are not devoted exactly specifically for the interreligious dialogue. The program was an example that how two persons from two different traditions, which clashed in the past, are ready to sit around the table to analyze burning themes with an open heart, even joking one with the other, is for a society, for the Argentinian society, in which dialogue is a subject which must be developed more and more. In Argentina we have a great problem of dialogue. And this is the point.
No, I'm quite happy.
I have now a non-political court question to your rabbi. Because you are in a very special position, you are a friend of the head of the Catholic Church. You are a friend of the Santa Claus, Francis. And you got the honoris doctorate of the Catholic University. You were invited for many Christians or Catholic events. I want to ask you how Jewish people from your community or in Argentina or your Jewish friends react on it.
I receive all kind of reactions from different people, but two rabbis, one very important rabbi in Israel, when I was accompanying Pope Francis in his pilgrimage to Israel, to the Holy Land, which means Palestine, Jordan, Israel, is when I talked with him, he said, you are doing a whole thing in your life. What you are doing is something holy, something very, very important. And I received this reaction as this commentary, as a commentary from a sage, because he is part, there is a committee in the Central Rabbinate of Israel named the Sages of the Torah. He is one of them. This for me was a very inspiring commentary, very, very important commentary, because it came from a person full with Torah, with knowledge, with spirituality. And he saw what I'm doing with the Pope, what first of all with the Archbishop, but then with the Pope as something very important, something holy, something blessed by God. And this, I take his words as an answer, and many Jews are considering very well, are applauding, to say something, our work, our work.
Father, I would like to tell something about the same situation. You also, you're working in a dialogue, how you're received here between in church as a person of interfaith and open dialogue.
I have no such a problem because I know that I follow the mainstream of the Catholic teaching. So, okay. Sometimes I think that we do not follow our own teaching, not only in the field of humanism or dialogue, Jewish Christian dialogue, but many things. We do not follow our own teaching, but this is our common fault. What I want to do is to follow the teaching of my church. I believe it's inspired by God's Spirit. I cannot do something different. I remember that we, that was a, was 6 years ago, I think. And you showed that I also sometimes do that. I also obey the teaching of my church sometimes because I don't know it. We try to prepare something what is called Assisi in Krakow, a meeting, inter-religious meeting of prayer, and doing something good in Krakow. It was wonderful rabbi in Krakow, and he was also, he was deeply involved in doing that. And we came to the moment where he said, okay, we can pray together. And I said, no. I said, my fault, my fault, my fault. And I think half a year later, I opened the teaching of one of the Vatican congregation. When it is, you know, black and white, that we are all encouraged to pray together with Jews. So it was my fault. I didn't know the teaching of my own church. That's why I behaved in a stupid way. Rabbi was open and he was ready to pray together. And I was afraid. Can I do that? No, we can pray together. But I'm quite happy because I know I will obey the real teaching of my church. So all those different opinions, to be honest, doesn't matter.
I have a very interesting question. What do you feel when you pray together, Jews and Christians, in front of innocents? Because you did both.
The challenge that I feel as a person, a descendant from two families, from my father's side, from my mother's side, that lost a lot of members in Auschwitz or the other concentration camps, is what I feel deeply. Maybe that this was the what inspires me at the end, at last, to be a rabbi, because my first intention was to be a chemist. I have a PhD in chemistry. And I said, okay, meanwhile I continue studying in order to know, just to know this. fulfilled a great part of my thirst of knowledge to study Talmud and to continue. And I finished and I got a title, a rabbinical sikha, rabbinical title, but God had other plans for me. And at the end, I devoted my life to rabbinics. But when I think, when I analyze why it occurred in this way in my life, occurred this in my life, the only answer that I can find is because I have the passion to make a turning point in history, that Auschwitz and Treblinka and Helmbrunn, no more for Jews, and no more for no other human being. And we have to pray together, we have to stay all Jews, Christians, agnostics, atheists, in some spiritual, we call that to pray together, but in some spiritual standing with a spiritual commitment to know we are not beasts, we are not worse than beasts, we are human beings. We must produce a turning point in history, and the only key we have to begin this turning point is dialogue. This is my passion, and because that, what means to pray together? We can pray a lot together. How? Saying Psalms. Psalms is a whole scripture for Christians and for Jews. Saying Pater Noster in Latin or Avinu Shebashamayim in Hebrew. It's exactly the same. Avinu Shebashamayim, our Father in Heaven. In heaven. Is because, as you said at the beginning, we have a transcendental, we believe in a transcendental Father who is with us, among us. This is what we are sharing, this belief, this faith we are sharing. And because that is important, to pray together or even to prepare some special moments for all human beings.
There are a few moments in my life that I were special, and I think about the common failure of Jews. The most important one for me was 4 years ago, I think. There was a concert at the gate of Birkenau, and the concert was called The Sacrifice of Innocence. And I think 10,000 people being present, and among them there were 50 bishops, half of the number from Poland and half from the world. Austria, from Germany, and there were 50 rabbis from all over the world. And there was a moment when he stood up and he sang Shema Israel together. I will never forget it. Most important, commandment. So the word coming from God and coming back to God, because we pray. But we know the passage from Isaiah. Isaiah says that my word do not come back to me without doing what it is sent for. The word of God is powerful. God can create word doesn't come back to him without doing. Without doing. But that Shema Yisrael, I think we were all also certain that we sing instead of those people who were killed. But I need to have a voice today. And we could give them a voice for a moment. They could sing Shema through our lips. But experience of community, incredible, completely incredible. 50 bishops, 50 rabbis, 10,000 people surrounding us, and we are singing Shema Yisrael. I will never forget.
Thank you very much. We had here experienced probably part of the people who are here. In 2004, it was 6th anniversary of the liquidation of the Rizal Ghetto, and it was the concert on the old market. And Joseph Malovano was singing Shema Yisrael. And in the moment when he started, it was a storm. And the sky opened, heaven opened, and it was raining. And it was incredible for most, for all the people. It was just like a godsend to people downstairs. Well, thank you very much. I have 50 more questions, but I know that probably some people have 50 more. So please, we have the possibility to ask some questions. If you have, please put your hand. Proszę Państwa, pytania, jeżeli macie, tylko musimy do mikrofonu, bo będą one tłumaczone dla rabina Abrahama Skórki. Czy ktoś z Państwa chciałby zadać jakieś pytanie? To może proszę zadawać po polsku, a będzie tłumaczone dla rabina.
Bliżej ust.
Jestem bardzo zbudowany, kiedy widzę przedstawicieli, jak to było wspomniane, tych, którzy są naszymi ojcami, tych, którzy są dziećmi, rozmawiający ze sobą w taki pokorze. Także nie często się zdarza. A moje pytanie do rabina, cieszę się, że mam okazję zadać. Trudno było pojechać do Abiodyty, żeby pytanie zadać, żeby przyjechał tutaj do nas, wielki przywilej. Ja rozumiem, że wspólnota żydowska ma problem z akceptowaniem Jezusa jako Syna Bożego ze względu na fakt, że ten człowiek nie powinien nazywać siebie ani uważać się do Syna Bożego. Natomiast jestem bardzo ciekaw z punktu widzenia wspólnoty żydowskiej, co brakuje Jezusowi, żeby był w oczach w zrozumieniu żydowskim Mesjaszem.
Może trwa chwileczkę tłumaczenie.
In accordance to my holiness, when the Messiah, how we are going to know that certain person is the Messiah is if the people of Israel will live in peace in the earth of Israel, if it will be peace around the world, and will come a person who is, by the way, the Messiah, in accordance to
to my mind, to our belief, is not the Son of God. It's like one of us, a person, and he is a descendant from David, as appears in the Gospels regarding Jesus, and he has certain special capabilities to judge person, to know exactly who is guilty and who is innocent, all kind of things. This way we can learn from chapter 11, Isaiah, is if this is going to be with this person, we will know that this is the Messiah. But I will tell you something. When the Messiah will come, okay, this is a question, maybe a question of God. For us, a question of God. For you also. Parousia is a question of God, the decision of God. But what we have to do is to work for the coming of the Messiah's time. And what I believe is that God will give us his answer, will send the Messiah when we will prepare the world to receive him. This is my answer.
Przygotowałem pytanie po angielsku, wobec tego może zadam, myślę, że wszyscy Państwo są już przyzwyczajeni do odsłuchania w tym języku. So I assume that this concept...
Henryku, do mikrofonu, mocno.
A teraz lepiej?
Bardzo dobrze.
I assume that this meeting has been inspired by tensions, recent tensions between Jews and Poles to some extent. To consider the questions which were raised here during the discussion, maybe I am in some way designed to add additional questions because I am a scientist, a pioneer of molecular biology in Poland and a student of somebody who was the designer of molecular biology in the world, in America. Therefore, the present problems of humanity one could define as something related to unliving matter, to living matter and to psychological matter. And in my opinion, we are dealing very well with non-living matter. We are fighting problems concerned living matter, but we are not prepared and not able to solve problems which are created by psychological parts of living matter. And therefore, the problems which arise right now, they are mainly created by the fact that people concentrate on living matter, but not on psychological living matter. The attitudes, for example, the problem of money. Money is a unit of values, material values, and people concentrate on money because they mainly deal with the problem of everyday needs, material needs. While what Christ was teaching is mainly dealing with psychological relations between people. So there is a question, is it possible to ask whether everything what was stated by Christ in the Bible. Is that answering the today's human race problems in psychological terms? If so, then one can say that what was said by Christ, if that solves the contemporary problems of humanity, it's coming from God. And that would, in some way, make the answer the question whether Christ is Messiah.
Następne pytanie bardzo proszę troszeczkę krótsze.
You first. This time you first.
To be honest, I have no idea what to say. The one thing that comes to me is this is not a psychology, it's something different. This is the vision of person, human person. And sometimes in Christianity, which are dedicated to solve the problems, and the two most important are responsibility and sin and salvation, forgiveness. If we do not use such terms, we create psychological problems. I've been once to the meeting of so-called Polish-Russian team for difficult tasks. There is such a thing. Polish-Russian team for difficult tasks. I wonder if there are any easy tasks between Polish and Russian. The meeting was held in Moscow, and the secretary of the Patriarch, Kirill, came to the meeting, and he said that, I don't remember exact number, but I think Peter, he said 70% of Russian people suffer depression. And he asked why. Because it was forbidden in Soviet Union to speak about sin. When you speak about sin, some people say that this is something offending human beings and that you distress them. No, it's not true. Because when you say, in Christian way, when we speak about sin, we say there is also a Redeemer. If we are not sure that we have a Redeemer from our sin, we will stop to speak about sin. You cannot leave a person with the idea of sin without showing him the way out. We say, there is a sin, my responsibility, my fault, also in place of the Jews, I can say many times, my fault. There is a forgiveness offered by God. There is a solving of the problem of evil. Not easy solving, not easy remedy. But I think that if you do not make a person facing those terms, sin, fault, forgiveness, you create psychological problems. This is my opinion.
I try to understand the essence, or if the person who asked that, I try to understand the essence, the quintessence of your question. What really was your question? If
religion or belief is a part of our psychological structure, and if and then it is merely what can I say, some utopia or some remedy, what? Yeah, or some remedy for my anxiety, for my existential anxiety. Look, since human being, since the first records that we have about history of humanity in the different cultures, in the different places, appears the searching of spirituality and of God. And this is for me a proof that beyond the powers and explanations of psychology, we have some kind of intuition. We have, as humans being, some kind of feelings, some kind of perceptions which bounds us to God. This is my answer. Psychology can explain a lot of things. Yes, a lot of things. But it's not more than a science. And science, you know very well, has limits. We don't know exactly where the limits are, but as we are going further and further, we are discovering new limits. Remain the story of the great professors of logic at the beginning of the 20th century, when they tried to build up a perfect mathematics, and what occurred with the paradox of Bertrand Russell, Bertrand Russell's questions. And the same even in quantum mechanics. We know a lot, but at certain moment, at the beginning is everything very, very logic. And in quantum mechanics, at certain point, and this is the opinion that shared with me a professor specialized in particles, in elementary particles, at certain point, you don't know exactly what you are speaking about. It looks like a mystery. And the same we can say about the theory of relativity. Okay, the first theory from 1905, okay, it's very logic, and we reach some very strange reality of four dimensions. But afterwards, with the use of tensors and of the general the theory of relativity from 1916, you enter in a world which is so strange and which is so far from common sense. Science is a very important tool for humanity, tremendously important. But we have to remember the Tower of Babel. God put limits to our knowledge. We will go further and further. Why? Because it appears in the Psalm number 8 that we are almost as God, but not God. But the Chasreu Me'at Melokim in Hebrew, that God created human being in a created in a way that there is a little bit between God and human being, but there is a little bit.
Thank you. have an expression in Polish that like, almost makes a difference.
Yeah.
My name is Grzegorz Ryś. I have a very short question to two of you. I asked if you believe in the evolutionary process of Darwin. The evolutionary process of Darwin.
Darwin.
Darwin. Darwin.
Yeah.
And plus, you were talking that the case was taking 2,000 years. That the Catholic Church or Christian Church is coming into dialogue with the Jewish. And or this only starts in 50 years before. So, as we are under pressure or challenges worldwide, do you think that we can speed up the evolutionary process of dialogue? Maybe in 100 years, there is no more indifference between Jewish and Christians.
Now, that's how the answer is simple. As a church, when we try to describe our faith, we said nothing about emotion. Either no, either yes, nothing. This is the subject for science. And since at least Second Vatican Council, we say that science has its own authority. Must be done in a human way. So, I mean, the science must be done by people who have conscience, that's all. But it is not a matter of the faith to correct the sentences of the science, especially natural history. It's completely different idea when we speak about creation. When we speak about creation, what is important for us is not how did God create the world. What is important is what does it mean that we are created. That means we are dependent on His will. Now, there is a small God between God and us, and the small God is the divine creation. And this is much more difficult for human beings today to believe that than to discuss the matters of evolution. Because when I say that God is creator and I am created, that means I depend in my being on Him. I am not beginning of myself. This is not my task to describe my beginning and my end. I am not a life giver. And I am also not a life giver to everything surrounding myself. There's a wonderful LCD collected by Francis, Lord have to see. And Francis says that we are very careful not to use the word creation. We said nature. Nature is a task for the science. Yeah. We have all the equipment to trace the nature, to say what the nature is, and what we can do with the nature to serve us, to be useful for us. But when we say creation, that means that the world is given to me by God. And this is also a sign of His trust to me, that I will not use the world in the wrong way, and that I can be responsible for the world, because it is created and it's given to me as a task, and not as my own thing to do whatever I want to do. So, Benedict XVI, he said that to proclaim today the dogma of creation is more important than to proclaim the dogma of redemption, because there is nearly no human being wanting to accept the truth that we are created. But this is what we say about creation, not how did it take place. No, this is not a matter of faith, this is a matter of science. do you think I will follow?
I have the same conception. I have not faith in the theory of Darwin. Science and faith are two separate fields that have to come in dialogue one with the other, of course, but they are two separate things. Why? Because the great difference between faith and science is this. If you propose a theory, you have to prove the theory. You have to go to the laboratory and to make experiments to show that your theory is true. Faith, you cannot prove. Not to kill a person, it's a matter of faith at the end. Because you cannot demonstrate in a logical way that it's bad to kill, or to rob, or to perform something wrong to a person, or the opposite, that it's very good to have mercy. No, the human values is also a matter of faith. Now, of course, that the religious people have to respect the consequences, the results of science, the conclusions of science. But there is a great difference. The challenge of each scientific theory is to be improved by the new one. Yeah, Newton was improved at the end by Einstein, and the idea is that it will come another person and will get at the end the whole theory relating all the forces in nature. The first chapter of Genesis is not a book, not of biology, and not of geology, and not we have not the description of the Big Bang. Meanwhile, the Big Bang is a very good theory. Why? Because it answers a lot of questions proved by laboratory experiments. But the most important thing of the first chapter is, as it was said, that there is a creature who produced this Big Bang. Meanwhile, Big Bang in the future, who knows how, what is going to be the more accurate a description of the beginning of the universe. And the most important is who human being is, that we have a spark of God in our being. Psychology is very important. It describes a great part of us. But our belief is that we have a spark of God, which is much more than what we use to understand as psyche, much more, some kind of intuition, which differences us from all the other creatures. This is our as I defined it at the beginning with the German word, Weltanschauung.
Thank you very much. And really, the last question, we have two last questions.
Here and there. But please, shortly ask. For me, it's a bit difficult. I don't know if I can for later on. The first thing is, Bishop said the story about the Pope who visited the temple, the Jewish temple in Rome, synagogue, and said that maybe for us, for Christians, for Christian Catholics, it was a new beginning. I see the same fact in another way, because I think it was a little bit too late, it took so long. Rabbi said something about identity of Jewish, about the connection between the religion and the nation. I don't want to criticize you absolutely, But in Poland, we have two traditions, as much as I see in my country. The first one is the tradition of tolerance, romantic tradition where all nations and cultures could be Polish, living together in peace, and another tradition which we haven't even started to talk about enough is the nationalistic tradition and the combination, the nation and the Catholicism, because the nationalists in Poland were built on Catholicism, not only on ethnic theory, but to be a Polish for Polish nationalists, nationalists were to be a Catholics. And the results of that thinking, which for me is against the Polish tradition, were very bad. And we even haven't started to talk about it, about the role, not in Holocaust, because it was not our fault, not we haven't started, but we participated. And Polish nationalism, that was something what is, for me, the evil, something what gave us not only the shame, but the result of it was just the death, just not help to our brothers, which were not only the citizens, because for me, Jewish living in Poland were Polish. I don't call them Jewish only. And I cannot imagine the Polish culture without Jewish poets, which were Polish, and the language, their language were Polish. The first language very often were Polish. So the question is, I give you an example from the little group, religion group in 16th century in Poland. It was a great time in Poland, which were called official the state of two nations, the Republic of two nations, and there were many nations living there together. I'm talking about 16th century, it's a great time for us. And there was a little group, and they were called Polish brothers. It's funny for today. Polish brothers. And one of them said, we must tolerate each other because maybe we are wrong. All of us can be wrong. And that's why we must tolerate each other. Not because we are keeping the truth, but we can be wrong. And that is the question. Is this easy for you, Rabbi, and for you, my bishop, to say something like, maybe I'm wrong, that's why I need the brother who thinks another way? Thank you.
My first thing I would say that it's not to the end of truth that there is no discussion on the subject. And I hope you will get a copy of the document signed by Polish Episcopate about the difference between patriotism and nationalism. There is a document written by Polish bishops, and it's not as old, it's just 1 year old. I remember myself signing the document. The nation is a value. The nation is a community which gave me my language. And in my language, there are many values implanted. It's a beautiful poem by Czesław Miłosz when he says that my language leads my hand. That's why I write truth with a big T and injustice with a small U. So the language is important. We have in Poland different streams of our tradition, different streams. And this is always our choice, which way we want to follow. There is something we call the Edelman tradition, and going back to the 16th and 15th century, To say very shortly, nation is a value. Nationalism is a
is a plastic. When you place a nation higher than your Lord. Lord must be the first. If you place Lord beneath the nation, this is something which is blessing. And that sentence is in the document. I remember when I heard it, because I was terrified. It was said for the first time, in, at least to my knowledge, in church's history, by Pope Pius XI in his document Mit brennender Sorge in 1937. And the document was written in German, in German, because it was dedicated to German nationalism. So now you have the same early quotation in Polish bishops conference of who cannot place the nation, the real nation, higher than your Lord. So the nation is a huge value. The one problem is that you need to put the value of nation in the right proper order. And then you follow your Lord, also be Polish. You follow your Lord, be Polish. To be Polish is a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing. It's a huge attraction to be Polish. It's not against anybody. So follow your Lord and do not be afraid of being Polish.
Just in order to clarify my answer regarding the Jews and Israel and so on, what I hope will be pragmatized in Israel is a democracy as it is. Israel is a full democracy. It works since the very day of its establishment of the state, a full democracy, with all the difficulties that a democratic system has. But, you know, as Churchill used to say, this is the best with what we have. Another system, a better system we have not. And the second point is that I hope that Israel will continue being forever democratic state and not a theocratia, and not a theocratic state. The religions must fulfill a very special spiritual task in each society, with respect, with sensitivity, and so on, and so on. But the structure of each society must be democratic. Why? Because democracy, when it is a real democracy and not a fake democracy, not when it is not merely a title, a definition, but we are, when you can build up, to build up a real democracy, you need the participation with a democratic way of thinking of the whole society. In Argentina we have formally a democratic system. Thanks God. But to live in a democratic country means that the citizens of that country knows how to behave and to defend democracy. This is a very important point. is this is what I wish for Israel, for Argentina, and even for Poland. Democracy means, first and foremost, to develop really what we did here. Dialogue. And a respectful dialogue from one towards the other, to know the other, to make an empathic relationship with the other, and so on, and so on, and so on. This is what, and I stress this point, what I tried to say at the beginning when I explained what means Israel. Well, and what is Israel? Because ultimately, we are just a part of a chain in the history, a continuation, and we must take pay attention to what appeared, to what occurred us in the past, to rectify what is wrong, the possibilities that we can do that, and to project an improvement of our own being for the future.
Could you add also, because all the people are talking about Christians and Judaic things, I want to ask you about your feelings about Poland and Poles. You have Polish roots. You are Argentinian Jew living in Buenos Aires, but you have roots here in Łódź, in Poland. So what are you feeling about Poland? The question was about also about the nationalism and about patriotism. So could you tell us something?
Undoubtedly that in the 20th century, I don't know exactly what happens and what happens before, because something is to study history, and something quite different is to hear history from the people that live that history. I had the testimonies of the generation of my grandparents who came to Argentina, who literally escaped from Poland for hunger and anti-Semitism. In 1938, what was a program in what city in Poland?
Pszczytyn.
In order not to go so far, there is a wonderful document prepared by Jacques Maritain, a great Christian theologian, a great. He addressed a conference about the situation of the Jews in Europe in 1938. It was published in French, and for my great surprise, also in Spanish in Argentina in 1938. And he describes the situation of the Jews in all the countries, especially in Poland. And at the end of his conference, a large conference, he speaks to the Polish people, do something that could be an example for all Europe, because I know your beliefs and your values. Help the Jews, something. I don't remember exactly the words, but he calls Polish people to help the Jews. Of course, that I would say this is some kind of trauma, but on the other side, the Jews of the generation of my grandparents, my father, when they used to speak about Poland, they referred to Poland as Yiddish, I will repeat, the Alte Heim, that were our old home. And they had a special feeling regarding Poland. And don't forget that Poland was one of the most important places in our 2,000 years of diaspora in the creation and recreation of Jewish culture, rabbis, intellectuals, writers, poets, a lot of culture was established here. And the main question, why Jews continue living in Poland during thousands of years? Because the history of Jews in Poland is a history of thousands of years. So, and I remember regarding the sentiments of my father regarding Poland, some mixed sentiments. From one side, okay, was a place of difficulties, but from the other side, they did consider Poland as their place. Till, of course, the Shoah, till the Second World War. So what is our mission? Our mission is to study a lot of history of the Jews in Poland and to rebuild in order to honor all that history, to rebuild new the relationships between Jews and the Polish people. The blood of my ancestors, the corpses of my ancestors are here, and the blood of my ancestors, the ashes of my ancestors are in the places of the concentration camps in here. But the idea is not to come to Poland only for grief, but to come in the future, to work a lot in order to come to Poland to life.
Archbishop doesn't want to say amen for the end. I want to thank you very much, Rabbi Abraham Skórka. And just for the end, the anecdote. Today, before this meeting, we discovered in the internet that it will be meeting Archbishop Grzegorz Ryś meets Abraham Hill in the Marek Edelman Center in Łódź.